So the atmosphere of the shot that you are now seeing is created by only one light source, which we have set up on the balcony. Welcome, friends. Hello, everyone. Today's location has a really beautiful view of Moscow, as you can see behind me. So the first idea that comes to mind is to take a picture of somebody placed against the background of this view. But we're not going to do that for two reasons. First of all, because it has become very hackneyed. It's been done by everyone, and it's become just boring. The second reason is that our aim is to shoot an interesting and informative lesson. Therefore, in our film, you'll not see anything spectacular. What we plan to do is to wait for night, which sounds a bit paradoxical. But when it's dark, we'll destroy the distractingly awesome view, and we'll use the balcony for a completely different purpose. We'll use it to set up our lights in order to illuminate the scene inside, trying different effects to simulate daylight or evening light, even perhaps some horror effects. This should give us a much more interesting and informative story, without being trivial, I hope. Let's see what we can do. Well, we've all been sitting around doing nothing for quite some time, drinking coffee, eating bananas, Instagramming, until the conditions we needed for our shot were right. As you can see behind me, it's now dark. We have a black city with lights. It's time now to consider where we will set the scene and what the plot will be. I think that the best spot for our shoot will be in the inner part of the room, which we'll light through the windows of the balcony door. As far as the plot's concerned, an idea formed when I met our model and discovered that she's studying philosophy. This reminded me of a certain insane student who became red-eyed from preparing for his exams. I believe that a person who studies philosophy at a higher educational institution is already insane, so I think that our model will fit into this image very well. Therefore, the first thing that I propose to do is build our scene according to this character's persona. And after that, we'll think about how we can set up the lights. Let's get going. Well, now you can see the scene exactly as it will be in our main shot. We have two windows, a table, a model that will sit on the floor in our picture. And I'm now going to start dressing the set a bit, making it more untidy. We'll put out lots of cups of coffee, pile up notebooks, scatter pens, and generally create the atmosphere we need. These two packs of sheets will also be scattered, but we'll only do that at the end of the shot, so that we can see them flying around our photos. For the moment, we'll leave them where they are. Now, I think think we've created enough of a mess. While we were doing this, we decided that our model should not only be studying, but also eating something. We thought of someone with a sweet tooth. We'd already scattered candy wrappers and jam around, but now we decided we also needed some pasta. There will be no story at all without pasta. So we need to go to the shop and get some pasta. Well, we have now finished setting up our scene, except that we have not yet cooked the pasta. But we won't wait for that. We'll now start setting up the lights. Our first and main light source will be the light through the window of the balcony door, which could simulate either daylight, evening light, or twilight. We'll try out various options, and you'll be able to see from the main camera how the scene changes. Today, this will be a bit of an experiment, due to the fact that I forgot to bring big stands, and we can therefore only use small DedoWeigert stands. The experiment will show whether they can manage to support such a large white light tool. Yes, it's holding up.
Итак, первый прибор, который мы попробуем поставить,
это The first device we'll try to set up is a 400-watt daylight tool. It's exactly this lighting tool that simulates daylight well. I set it so that it does not shine directly into the camera and just peeks out a little from around the corner. I think we can achieve the desired effect like this. Now I'll check the main camera and see what kind of picture we get from this effect. Now you can see in the main shot that this is almost the ideal source for simulating daylight. It looks very natural to me. There's one small problem. You can see a dark balcony door in the background. However, we can obviously not put light through this glass as we're very high up. Therefore, we will deal with this problem in Photoshop. Getting the main light of the shot is easy to do. And now, whilst remembering how it looks in the daylight, we'll try to put in the second source and create a feeling of the setting sun. This filter is not good for us, because it doesn't look like natural lighting at all. It looks more like the sort of light you would find in a medical office. Perhaps if we were shooting an operation in a morgue, we would have such a light. So we'll change it. Now this seems to be a very interesting light. I feel that it gives an evening effect, with a touch of neon from a light advertisement. We'll put this color on standby, because we might use it in our scene. Next one. No. Put it away. It's so artificial. Let's try orange. It's a very aggressive color. Is there something lighter? This gives a warm, pleasant daylight effect.
Теплого, приятного дневного света, чуть-чуть из-за облаков, это вполне...
A little bit cloudy. It would do well if we wanted to shoot a sweet lyric picture.
Няшную лиричную картинку.
Yeah, that's what our model is doing now. Good girl. But since I want some drama in the story, it's absolutely useless. Let's try the yellow filter again. Now this is something more like sunset. Let's get stronger. No, this is a very artificial option. Just two filters must be put together. So what if we try the third one? Here is what we see in the shot now, this feeling of the setting sun. If we wanted to shoot the shot in this way, I would only change one thing. I would move the lamp a little lower in order to position the light in such a way that it seems as though the sun is already setting below the horizon. According to the color, it seems to me that this is necessary. We saw how it looks, but my feeling is, for this shot, it's not good. I like neon color more. Let's try something else and stop when we find some specific atmosphere. Here there are two options. Either this is horror, or it's a photographer who developed his negatives in a dark room. So this filter is not good. Let's try one more. Perhaps a blue one. Also, no. Now, having tried several different filters, my feeling is that we should build on the filter that created the greenish neon light. So I will try to mix it with something. I think now we've done the trick. We no longer have a green filter, as it was originally, with a neon light, which seemed to me to be too aggressive, but a mixture of two filters, the green one together with a warm filter. This way, I think the light has become more natural for the shot. Plus, in this light, we can adequately add additional warm sources from the inside, and they will look good. Friends, I want to say a few words about the perception of color, the feeling for atmosphere, and for the philosophy of the shot. I want to point out that in cases like this, there are no hard and fast rules about what is true or untrue. It's all about personal taste. And whatever the person behind the camera thinks is good is right. Now, I am that person behind the camera, so what I feel is good is right. But if someone else were now behind the camera, then his ideas of what is good would not be right. In situations like this, where it's a matter of atmosphere and psychology, you must first trust all of your own feelings about what is right. So, the atmosphere of the shot that you are now seeing is created by only one light source, which we have set up on the balcony. It's daylight, white light, covered by two filters. One is a dark turquoise, the other is light warm. My feeling is that maybe this is enough to make a shot. But I'd like to add a few effects. To begin with, there is this second window, which is absolutely dark. Of course, it would be very problematic to light it, but at least we'll try to highlight it through the balcony window in order to reduce the amount of Photoshop work that we will have to mess around with later. And then we also need to include some light sources so that we can see more of the set. We'll have to think how we can do that. We have two options. Either we'll emphasize some details of our setup by placing precise separate light sources, or we will introduce a real light source into the shot. We have an interesting floor lamp here, so we will put it on the set and see what it gives us in color, in light, and how it can all be combined later. Let's try. Thank you. Friends, we have a small problem with regards highlighting the second window, which we really would like to do, because there are objects reflected on it, and it will take a long time to paint in the light with Photoshop. But the idea of setting another light on the balcony through two windows doesn't work, because the angle is wrong and the picture doesn't look natural. In order to get a realistic shot, we've had to put it directly out of the window, whereby there is a danger that it might drop and fall on the head of somebody passing by. So we can't leave it like that all the time, only for the final picture and literally only for 5 minutes. I recommend that you always observe safety carefully. See that your equipment is reliably fixed, because when things fall from a height, there may be big trouble. Well, now you can see what we've done to the set. We've put a floor lamp into our composition, which we really need for the plot. But to be quite honest, I find that the result is a bit frustrating, because there is a lot of white light coming from this lamp. And what I want is a limited, narrower yellow spotlight that gives an aesthetically pleasing light on our model and part of the scene. Instead, I have a strong white light which spoils the balance of the whole shot. This often happens, and it may even be good that it happened for our lesson, because it will show one method which is used very often in real shooting. The light of one source, which is not in the shot, we will replace with the help of two DedoWeigertFilm tools, and thus we will get the quantity and quality of light that we need for the story. Let's see how we do it. Let me explain how we will simulate the light of the floor lamp. The first tool will perform the following action. It will light the inside of the lampshade, creating the impression that there is a light inside. The only thing for which is needed is to illuminate the lampshade from the inside. This is a very precise operation, and therefore, in addition to the 150-watt instrument itself, we will add a DP1 projection attachment to it that we can use for focusing the light. We will also insert an iris into this projection attachment, with which I can vary the ray width very accurately. And now we position the device in such a way that it projects the light from the floor, from bottom to top, up to the ceiling, and in such a way that it does not get into the shot. Here, the advantage of DedoWeigertFilm works very well, because the instruments are small and can be hidden everywhere. Now I'll turn it on and you'll see the effect. We will send it first to the area that we need. Let me show you on the wall how the iris works. I can narrow or expand the ray with the slider. I will direct the light in such a way that it only lightens the inside of the lampshade and does not touch the outer part, since this would not be natural. Such a light inside the lampshade is enough for us to feel that there is a light bulb burning there. And then, with the second tool, we will simulate the light coming from the floor lamp onto the place where we need it. Let's now put up the second tool. we will try to position the second tool, which will simulate light from this floor lamp. I'm not yet sure what kind of projection attachment we need, so we'll try two options. First, we will focus the tool as much as possible and use the barn doors instead of curtains. If this light is too much and the ray too wide, then we will do the same thing we did with the device that lit the inside of the lampshade. We will put on the projection attachment with the iris inside. Let's try and see what happens. In this case, I want the light to cover a small part of the table, which would logically be illuminated by the floor lamp, picking up the cups and the tea bags and some of the things on the floor, as well as part of the model. If this light touches the lampshade from the window side, it is not critical, because in the shot it will not be visible. The main thing is not to get on the lampshade from the camera side. That would be wrong. Let's see what we get. I don't worry about the fact that I highlighted part of the ceiling and part of the leg, as it won't be visible in the picture. The main thing is for me is to get a beautiful shot. We don't need that much light. So we'll just dim it a bit. During this process, I have discovered that even two light sources are not enough to give a good imitation of light from this lampshade. Because if we shine light from such a distance, we get two very unpleasant shadows, which will be visible to us in the shot. The shadow from the floor lamp stand and the shadow from the table. Therefore, in order to simulate the light from the floor lamp that falls to the floor and partly on the feet and hands of the model, I will move our light source here to this place. To avoid touching the footstand of the floor lamp, I will place the light right next to it. But to simulate the light from the floor lamp that falls on the table, we have to set a further device so that we can place the light locally and very accurately exactly on that part of the table that the floor lamp should illuminate. Let's do it. Now, you can see that the shadow is still there. But we will position this shadow in such a way that it doesn't bother us. That is, we will cast it behind the model. The model in shot will cover the shadow from the table. We'll light up that part of the table that we need. We need to get the feeling that you've been sitting here for a week, that you've eaten all this, and not only this, but mountains of food that we don't see. And we don't see the mountains of notebooks, etc., that you've used. By now, you're starting to go crazy. You will have papers and a pen in your hand, and at some point, you no longer know what you're doing. And you just fling up the papers and pen and lie down and try to eat the pasta. And whilst we are photographing all this, someone will throw up the sheets of paper. And then we'll fly around you. We'll drop the sheets that line our table over there. That's what we'll do. That's it. I think everything is fine. So we've got our picture. I think it turned out to be an excellent psychedelic shot. Even better than what I expected. Because our model, Elizabeth Sergeevna, made her considerable contribution by venturing to eat the pasta that was lying on the table. Apparently, she was wildly hungry. Friends, let me say a few words about this device, which we put out of the window over the street on a long tripod. If we'd done this correctly, then we would have had to put the same two gel filters on it that we had on the main light. But we left this for Photoshop for two reasons. Firstly, we had to stick the light far out over the street. It was windy and the gels would have acted as sails. In the picture, it shines only on a very small local area on the side, and therefore it will be easy to correct in Photoshop. I really hope that you liked today's lesson. We did something interesting and tried several different options. Thanks. Thank you very much. See you soon. Subscribe to the channel. You will find many interesting videos there.